hearing on Comcast, the renewal of the Comcast franchise license. And I will ask if anybody has any questions or comments on the Comcast franchise license.
I do.
Yes, please.
Now, other places have MetroCast.
Yes.
Is that a possibility here, or, I mean?
I don't know if MetroCast has the same suite of services that Xfinity or Comcast provides.
Rochester, right?
Yeah.
Rochester's on the town's north of Rochester. I don't know anything about it, though.
Are you thinking that it would be cheaper? It would?
I have no idea. I know nothing about it. It aggravates me that there is no competition.
That's the way it's written. That's the way that I don't know whether it's under FCC. It's sort of like regulated like public utility.
Yeah, right.
More than anything else. So, you know, it's like, so that, you know, it's not that we could bring in a second one. We can't bring in a second one and have people choose. So we either have this particular, you know, either Comcast score, or we would have MetroCast, or we would have, you know, whatever.
Thousands of cable companies across the country.
Yeah, but they operate some of them in just...
Right, in very small locales.
Yeah. So to my knowledge, in this area, Comcast services this area, and I don't even know if MetroCast, I don't know what its field is. It's possible that, you know...
Rochester. Someone wrote this, Comcast, too, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
Because they're a public access station.
Is there Comcast?
Excuse me, right now I don't...
So good question, but that's about all I know about that.
Comcast is such a big company that...
Everyone.
Do you use Comcast?
Mm-hmm.
And Sally, do you use it?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I use it. There was a time when you...
I don't, for cable, I mean for internet, rather. But
yeah. So not for the internet.
And telephone.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Is there anyone else who would like to speak to this? All right, it's only 6:02. I'm not going to close this. I'm going to wait. I'll wait till at least 6:05, and we'll just check.
So legal counsel is looking at the contract, though.
Yes.
It hasn't been, it's just been extended every year or every so many years for decades of continental cable vision.
Exactly, 1972,
right.
I think. So this year, though, this is prompted because Comcast sent us something different. It wasn't just the automatic extension. Mm-hmm. I think they're looking for an actual renewal. So that's why we refer it to legal.
Now, do they pay money?
Yes. Well,
are
you pay.
Are they going to give more money?
You pay money.
Right.
Ah.
All
you,
the customers.
If you look at your detail, bill detail, which, and I don't think it's necessarily with every bill, but it's probably at least twice a year or something, you'll see there's a franchise agreement fee, and
mm-hmm.
it says 3%. That
mm-hmm.
comes directly to the town. That's the $28,000 revenue line that the town brings in.
Mm-hmm.
When I first came on the board, the whole amount went into the general fund, which really the intent of it is to go for things that are supposed to be for open government, for you know, things related to what Comcast does. So the first year I was on the board, I requested as part of the budgeting process to take at least 10,000 of that revenue, put it with the internet, our IT line. That was that's the source of funding for that IT line. And it was 10,000, it's a little bit less than that this year, but that is the...
At least it's going to information technology.
Exactly. And, you know, the fact that our Google Drive and putting in stuff that, you know, making things accessible online. So, we have talked to people in the past about starting a channel. You know, Mike Gillis has been, Mike Gillis is the Dover media person, and he lives in town. So he was on our advisory committee in open government when he was active. And we were talking about the contract. And, you know, at this stage of the game, he says there's very little you can wrest from these cable companies. You know, there's very little that they'll do for you. And if we wanted to make it more than, we can make it more than 3% revenue, we can make it up to 5% revenue, but it's going to come right out of your pocket,
right.
And your pocket,
right.
And my pocket.
Right.
I apologize for being tardy.
Oh,
I apologize to the public for being tardy. You are, that's good.
Well, traffic wasn't as bad as I expected on the Portsmouth. Thank you, Portsmouth and New England.
So anyway, that's the, I don't know what I was saying, but that, you know, we could make, it's okay. We could make it 5%, but it comes right out of everybody's pocket, so. I'd say that the board is unwilling to do that. I don't know that this board has ever really talked about that. So I'll repeat it again so Jody can hear it. And that is that our current agreement with Comcast, which is the purpose of this public hearing, we charge, we don't charge, we under the agreement that we have been operating with them, there's a 3% franchise fee that is paid by everybody who has Comcast. And that comes to the town, and that's the $27,000, $28,000 in revenue that we have. It is possible under the whatever charter regulations and whatever for us to charge 5% franchise fee, but it wouldn't come out of Comcast's hide. It would come out of the hide of all of us who use it. So the board hasn't actively discussed doing it any more than 3%, but we could. All right, anybody else who would like to speak to the Comcast renewal? Let's see what time is it. It's 6:06. All right, going once, going twice, going thrice. I will close the public hearing on the Comcast cable renewal. Agreement was signed in 1972. And it was good for 15 years, automatically renewed for another 15 years. So that took us to like 2000, whatever, you can do the math, 2002, something like that. At that point, we were getting like 3-year, just like renewal, and the board was just signing them. And sometimes it was maybe 2, maybe 1 year. And when I got on board, I said, well, why are we just signing this? Where's the original contract? What are we extending? They were just extensions. And so we've been talking about entering into formal negotiations to actually renegotiate the contract. And so this is what's happening right this very moment. Now we're not expecting really anything different, dramatically different.
The problem is there's nobody out there to compete with them that's in front of any of our homes. That's the problem.
Yes.
I'll plow up some old time, but a year ago, less than a year ago, back last in 16, on the web, they had the top worst 10 companies in the nation. Comcast was in the top 5. As a matter of fact, if my memory serves me right, they were the number 3 or 4. Their customer relations is non-existent. If you told me BIOS was coming by my house next week, I'd have Comcast equipment out of my house before 7 o'clock tonight. That's how much I really dislike them. One of the football games I was watching leading up to the Super Bowl was in Spanish on Channel 4. Well,
I believe you. I obviously was spared that particular thing. But.
Well, that's good.
Yeah.
I called their customer service, and I got a young lady on the end, very very pleasant to talk with. I mean, I just don't laugh at me. Why is my TV coming in Spanish? And she says, "Sir, I'm not going to laugh at you." We tried to straighten it out. It wouldn't. So I got mad and turned it off. Turned it back on. It was in English. Well, then she tells me, she says, if it happens again, push the D button. It might help you. If that don't help, you're going to have to bring it to Portsmouth. Why have I got to bring it to Portsmouth? It's your junk. True?
Yeah.
I mean, it's your equipment. I'm renting the damn stuff.
Yeah.
So I ended up taking to Portsmouth. Now I got one that won't turn off.
The box won't turn off?
No, and I'm dead serious. The price they charge to me is, I don't think, if anybody in town says they're getting a good deal, you better hang on, because you're really in the minority.
Yeah, so I mean, so I would say the people who did express an opinion, there aren't many of us here who were here at 6 o'clock.
I'm sorry I didn't make it at 6,
no,
it's
no,
my bad.
That's okay. you know, nobody's excited, but, you know, the only other, you know, people have mentioned MetroCast, but we don't even know if they come down this far, nor do we know what level of services they provide. And, you know, it's set up so that whatever you do, that a town only has one at a time. So it's not like we would ever have two and you could choose.
Well, out of curiosity, would it hurt? I don't know if, we'll say one of you three were able to get through to Verizon, see if they would even, now that your contract's coming up, would they even entertain coming into town?
No, they don't serve Northern New England anymore.
Yeah, they do.
No, fair point.
No. Fios is...
But Fios is not...
Fios is not... Verizon.
Yeah, but it's not cable, it's a different...
Yeah.
It's a different technology than I...
I don't know if they would entertain it or not.
I don't know that it replaces Comcast. You think so?
Yes.
So some towns just do Fios?
No, they can, you know, that's a good question. I don't know how to answer that. I'm living in that area where...
I mean, I understand that's one case where you could choose, I mean, you could, if we had Fios and if you could connect to it, you could just choose not to do any cable and do Fios.
Right.
But we, the town, Fios would not have a cable franchise arrangement with us. That's the point I was trying to make. So we can have, for whatever reason, whatever the enabling legislation is, I don't really know, we can have only one cable franchise agreement, and it's currently with Comcast, and that's the one we are currently doing.
You can enter into one of those dish contracts.
Yes. So you...
But it's not an actual cable company.
Correct. So you could do DSL from your phone for internet. You could do Fios if it were available for a lot of internet services. You could do a dish for some kind of... But from a cable franchise agreement, a town or municipality or whatever has one at a time, and ours is currently with Comcast, and we're in...
So what happens if you don't... What do they do? Just turn the whole town off?
We don't renew it?
I guess.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Really?
I think you're angry in Spanish. You're even more angry if you don't get into Spain.
Could you imagine a whole town descending on Air Portsmouth office? I could see them running out the other end.
I would say the pitchforks would come at us first.
The lines are long enough as it is.
Yeah, I would say the pitchforks would come here first before they go to Portsmouth. That's my guess.
Our
videographer is getting the ambiance.
I just can't see you.
Okay.
So just ignore me. I'm not here.
Okay, we were hoping to get some of that fresh air.
I'm not covering that part.
Hi, Caroline. How are you?
All right.
Thanks.
How are you? Are there any other questions or comments on the Comcast franchise agreement? Going once? Going twice?
Well, come on, people.
Three times, we close the public hearing again, and...
Oh, I thought I didn't remember.
I will call to order the select board meeting of April 17th, 2017, at 6:31. We were going to do right away a review of a USDA loan resolution, but we are waiting for Kate Nesman, and we weren't sure when Jody was going to be here, so that would probably... No worries. That would probably happen at 7. So we'll just carry on until such time. So we'll do the approval of minutes, and then we'll check in with our committee members. So there are three sets of minutes. I did read the April 10th, and I made changes from Chaz to Chad, and I just added that the bond council, Jody and I, would be available for both purchases and any document associated with the bond council.
Yeah.
That was the only changes that I made. So is the board okay with both the regular meetings, the special board meeting when we did the fire contract, and...
I didn't read the public information session, but you all did that look like...
It's pretty short, because it's not even a public hearing. It was just a public information session. So are you okay then?
Yeah,
okay.
By consensus.
Okay, by consensus, those are all done. All right, so now we're open for community input. Anybody? Okay, right.
Hi, I'm here on behalf of the Wellsburg Public Library, and At our last meeting, we had voted to add another alternate to our board, and we weren't able to have up to three. At this point.
I'm sorry, you are able to have up to three?
Up to three. At this point, we only have one, and we decided to add a second one just in case. After reviewing everyone that would be available to do something like that, we decided to recommend Liz Marcotte to the position. Liz has been a trustee in the past. She was one of the founders of the library and has exhibited an excellent commitment to the library over the years since it's been founded. So we'd like her to be named to the board, so choose.
Thank you. Board, comments, questions, motions?
What was the vote? Was it unanimous?
Yes, it was.
So, reason I ask, because Liz had been on previously and had to resign because she couldn't make the.
Yes.
So it's just.
This is an alternate position.
Have a motion to.
Sure, I'm moving to accept. The recommendation.
Recommendation from the library trustees. So I think I heard a second.
Second.
Any other questions or comments? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Thank you. Well, thank you, and then send our congratulations to Liz and thank her for her willingness to serve. Any other community questions or comments? Caroline, are you here for welfare?
No.
Okay. Tom, are you here to talk to us about something?
Yes.
Please come up.
Thank you.
I just wanted to fill you in on the inspection that Jeff and I did of Matt Randall's.
Oh, this is the, was it, did you go to?
No.
No, you went yourself.
No, we sent them.
Okay, Plummer Road, yes, thank you.
Okay, we met with Matt. We heard his issues, which are valid. I mean, the culvert, which is only like a 6 or 8 inch ductile iron pipe, clearly has been there for decades. Matt seemed to recall it was cleared out like a couple of years ago, but the guy that did it, Jeff was telling me, didn't work there for like the last 8 or 9 years. So it's been a while, and it's very clear that it's accumulated, you know, dirt, leaves, runoff, et cetera, for many years. It looks like, and Jeff can explain, if we, the town, wants to clean it out, I guess it's a fairly easy process.
Yeah, just gonna have to drop.
From one side? Can we do it from just one side?
Yeah, what it is they put a hose in, high pressure hose, and then they'll add on the sprays water, and they clean it out that way.
So we could do it from the side we have access?
But the water's not gonna run freely, right? It's plugged up at the other end.
Well, see, that's the thing. It will. There is the culvert, so to speak, is sloped, you know, from Randall's to across the street, but it's a minimal pitch, and it's gonna be at least, what, like 8 inches below grade, so
okay.
It will work for a little while. It will, I think, affect the ponding just off the side of the road, but the pictures that he showed are further back in his house.
Right.
I don't think it's gonna have any effect on that. And like Jeff pointed out while you're out there, just the natural lay of the land is a low spot. And I don't think cleaning the culvert out, I mean, it might help for a little while, but I don't really think it's gonna alleviate his main concerns.
There's a little bit, from the road, I didn't go into the yard, but from the road, it looks like there's a little bit of a little berm or something before you even get to the ditch line, right?
I mean, no, we're talking
about. On the side, or is it on the other side?
Which side are we talking about?
So the flooding, that was, the pooling of water was happening in the back of this property?
Of Randall's property.
Right, of Randall's property. And even if it were pitched the other way, it looks like there's a berm of some kind on his side of the property, on Randall's side of the property, before you even get into the ditch line. Is that?
There's a high.
But from the car level, that's what it looks like. I don't know what it looks like.
There is a bit of a high spot, but with the culvert, you know, so far below grade. I mean, you're right, it's basically ineffectual.
So it's not going to affect the pooling of water in his backyard, which is what he was complaining about, right?
No.
So.
So, yes,
Jane. Did you explain to Mr. Randall that pooling is not from that? It's the septic design is so high. Well, it's supposed to be high, but. When they did the septic, they should have ran that water line.
His first septic, his leach field, the first septic design was actually at the level of where the water was pooling.
Uh-huh.
when they redesigned the septic system, they put a raised bed in.
Right.
Which is probably 5 feet tall than the actual land.
Right, so instead of diverting the water behind the septic. So my second question is, first, it's not a right, it's not a correct culvert. It's not a culvert. And two, we don't have easement for the water to drain to the next property.
Not that I'm aware of. I was going to look at the deed for that property, but.
Across the street?
Yeah.
I think it's pretty clear that we have no.
Oh, well then.
You know, the town is not aware that we have any kind of prescriptive easement or anything of that nature. So is it worth any even just PR or goodwill to try to blow that out? And if so, what would that cost?
If I scheduled it when we do catch basins, I mean, they might do it, you know, for.
What does the board think about that?
You're blowing out an illegal culvert into someplace we have no easement.
Well, the culvert's not illegal. I mean, it's our culvert. I mean, it's there, right?
But it's not a culvert, it's a pipe.
Okay, but it's in our right, it is.
Okay, we still don't have an easement.
Well, we're not going to touch the.
Well.
It's going to.
Just said, it's, the water is pushed in with some force, so there's going to be.
Oh, I see, I see.
Discharge.
Okay, so it does have an impact.
On the other side of the street where the end of the culvert has been buried.
Yeah.
Filled in. Is there a ditch line? I don't remember. Is there any kind of ditch line on that side? There isn't, right? So.
If you look at the line of the road, at the edge of the road, in front of this residence house, you can actually see where they filled it in, where it actually kicks out, and you see the line of the road being up.
So we're kind of, I think we're kind of back then to just thinking that when we get to Clement Road from a road plan point of view, that we could address it at that time.
I think that, as you point out, it would be good from a PR perspective. And they, excuse me, also illustrates Mr. Randall that the main ponding he's concerned about isn't going to be affected, no matter how clean it is. But on the other side,
even if we got easements, a 16-inch pipe, and
the water isn't making it to the ditch line.
It's not. He would have to have somebody with redirect that water past the septic design behind it.
Yes.
And that's not us.
Yeah,
that is not us.
That's entirely,
that is his property.
Right.
So that's just like my neighbor running her water off of her lawn and down.
I guess the next step is to have the send a letter, have the Randalls come and have a conversation.
Well, I was just going to say, Tom, could you draft something that has your observations?
Yeah.
And we could say when we're planning on doing the road. And I don't know if there's anything we can do at that time, but that's a time when we can at least look at it.
We could take out that pipe that's kind of a culvert, but not really.
Right.
And redo the ditch line on that
on
side,
that,
on the
Randall
on the right side of
yes.
the left hand side, depending on which way you're going.
As
over the road correctly, but I mean.
Yeah, as we're finding with Clement Road, we're probably going to have to put in the swells on both sides all the way down the road.
We might, yeah.
Especially with the new development coming in and that side already being taken out, so with the rock and so forth.
Is it Clement Road work scheduled for this year?
Oh God,
no!
No, I'm bringing it up.
I don't.
Sorry.
Oh, okay.
No. Yeah, none of us will be here by then.
We can say anything. Then.
Right.
Well, no, because I'd like to think that the board, however it's constituted, would have some allegiance to, you know, a strategic planning effort that we have started. But you know, we can't bind any future board, just like we refuse to be bound by any. Prior one.
Yeah,
so
I think
let's
they're like
see.
10 years out.
Oh, where are we? Sidewalks, Locust Pine, Big Clement.
What year?
2023.
And inform me.
So if I put that date in the letter.
It's probably subject
to change, too. I mean,
subject to change.
Yeah.
So we could just say. Perhaps rather than stating the year, which is public anyway because it's on the plan and here we are talking about it, we just say that when we redo Clement Road, we will be looking at the overall drainage, particularly on that side of the road.
But they have to know that that pond is not formed from drainage, it's formed from their septic design being so high.
After Jeff and I talked with him, he kind of reluctantly admitted that.
Okay. I don't want him to think that we're coming in with a backhoe and draining that for him.
No, we made that pretty clear, right? That's.
We have wonderful excavators in town that would be happy to give him a bid, I'm sure, but.
Okay. Thank you for going, both of you, appreciate it. We'll just wrap that letter up.
Alright.
Anything else on?
Nope.
Anything else, Tom, that you need to talk?
I'm sorry, one more thing. Three Highland, they have put in a building permit to put in an office in their barn, and over a year ago.
Just wanted to say that, remember?
So we approved that, that we signed that for you, but I don't think it was ever completed. But they do have new wood above, at the barn roof line. But I don't know if they've ever completed the, I don't know if they ever came in for an extension or anything.
I don't know, they're gonna put in a small home office or something.
So what is the concern, that they don't have a valid permit at the moment?
I don't know if it was ever finished, and if it was finished, he would be inspecting it at this point now, right?
I would think so, sure. I'll call him, that's Martin, all right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
I'll do my best.
It just dawned on me the other day, so.
And I couldn't help but notice Main Street, the house on Main Street's doing something. I assume that we have building codes for that.
Which house?
I don't know, I drove by and it, they had a contractor sign up, you know?
Your house is like that.
Yeah, so I don't know, I mean, I went by and I was gone before I noticed, so.
What about a settlement circle?
Is that it?
Oh, yeah, so I don't know.
Is it green sign?
Yes, yeah.
A landscaping company.
Oh, it's landscaping, oh, okay.
But I think the sign, if I remember correctly, was like stone walls, landscaping, and something else on it. So I don't know what they have done, I don't know. Now that you said it, now I think I saw.
Yeah, they're just reseeding their lawn or putting in some shrubs. Okay, I guess we're good.
Alright.
Yes, thank you so much, Tom.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Okay.
This is the guy who puts big jet mine in the wallet.
That's right, I'm gonna go over some more.
Do you have stuff for us?
I just have a purchase.
I put you again, guys, I didn't set the bomb off.
Purchase order related to 95 Washington Roadway Services, street sweeping down this year. The purchase order is not to exceed $2,500, and his rate of sweeping is $95 an hour. And he had the company to give that $115 an hour.
So, let's talk about stormwater for a minute.
Yep.
So, street sweeping is an important consideration if you're approving stormwater management and if you're working on your MS4 permit for.
I have his through the email, Mike, so yeah, I can print it off.
This will be on the picture, okay.
So street sweeping is one of the things that, you know, we should be doing with regard to our permit, and it's will be in our notice of intent, it's in the prior permit. But with regards to documentation, it's possible at some point we might need to better document, like, how do we know how much he's swept up? Is there any way to figure that out?
I can keep track of his loads.
Why don't you try?
Back when we were doing sand, back when we were using sand, we were probably about 18, 20 yards of material. And now that we switched over to salt, we're probably 6.
So that's an interesting piece of data. So it would be helpful to us to report that on our permit. So if you could take note again this year, that would, you know, just write it down, send an email.
Yep.
That would be helpful.
Absolutely.
Okay, so, yep.
Some blanks, sorry. I'm going to purchase order number 09, sorry, I forgot the middle. 0951, that correct?
Yes.
To show them roadway services for up to $2,500 for street sweeping.
Thank you.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. I had to make sure you were reading it correctly.
Thank you. I'm glad. It's in bold, so I missed it. It's a number.
So, let's see, we have a few things on the list. One is Prospect. You know, Mr. Brunel has come in a couple of times, and we haven't resolved this yet. So what I'm hoping is that you and perhaps a board member can go out and inspect it together and maybe measure from the center of the road to wherever his work things are.
I went by the other day, actually. So it's, yeah, I'm happy to work with you again. Okay, the brick pillars are right up against the road, and the telephone poles that are for utility poles that are further back than the...
So if we can get a measurement, and if there's an argument that says his brick pillars are within the right of way, then if we can do that, if not...
We never hit his brick pillars for a while.
He did say, he didn't do it as part of a meeting, he did it before a meeting. He came to me again like 2 weeks ago, and he said he had talked to a police officer, and the police officer said, oh yeah, that looks like the plow hit. So
yeah.
I'm not...
I'd like to read the police department's report on that, because it's going to be reported now. I'd like to see that report.
So you can...
Absolutely.
Check
I'll be talking to Bob tomorrow.
Okay. So if we could get a measurement, that would be helpful. All right, thank you. Next on the list is smoke test notifications. So this has to do with Foundry South Street, where we're putting the under drain, and we know that there's an open pipe. Is how many feet down?
It's approximately 6 feet down.
6 feet down. And so what we want to do is get some help from Dover. They've offered to help, so we're hoping that they'll be able to put some kind of smoke bomb, so that at the other end, whatever house this is coming from, they will be able to tell. And what the town would like to do, it's in our right of way, is to close this. But we want to make sure that homes, anyone that has this, has appropriate notice. And we want them to have appropriate notice before we start this testing. So I will ask you and Caroline to make sure that, you know, we send letters out to the folks that are, we think are there, or put something on the website.
Send letters out, put stuff on the website.
Maybe even a sandwich board that's on the corner so that they can call in if they want some information. We need to give them a few days notice, or just say it's happening between here and here, whatever. Ward, are you good with that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. All right, thank you. All right, do we otherwise have any, and also we're gonna need a schedule for the road work so that we can just, in general, let the town know about that.
They were planning on starting this week, Wednesday, but we have weather coming in, so we're postponed until next week.
So
providing all the bonds and permits and day safe done, we'll plan on the following week to start.
Can you put something on the website? See, you shouldn't come to these meetings because it's too easy for me to...
What's their estimated date on this project,
Probably start on Monday.
So next Monday they're okay.
Depending, like I said, if all the bond paperwork's in, they've saved on all their stuff. I mean, it's a series. And the weather, I mean, if it's going to have a week of rain, we're not going to start.
Do you know where they're starting? What location?
They're going to start laying under drainage.
They're going to start Foundry then?
Right, yeah, we're going to start on Foundry Street.
Okay.
So pretty much they're going to lay all the drainage, the 4-inch drainage. They're going to lower all our structures, plate them, and then they're going to start reclaiming, and then they'll start shaping the road, and then they'll come back in, shape our swales, pave it, and then come back and hand pave our swales, and then they're going to overlay.
Okay, so let's talk about the non-kosher driveway that is on town, known to be now on town property because of the survey we did. And you want to tell us the issue that you see with that driveway? Call it a driveway, I don't know what else to call
it. Yeah, swales usually are not made to drive through on a constant basis. So therefore, what's happening now is you actually see the wheel ruts in the swale when it's broke. Small where it's traveled in and out every time. So I'd like to put a stop to the parking in this parking spot that somebody has just created for himself. And it's actually town property.
They're doing damage, yeah.
So we could put up a sign that just says no parking, town property.
We told that resident we would get back to them.
Right.
We did. He never came to see us.
We told them we would get back to them.
We did get back to them. We sent him a letter.
With the survey?
Yeah, we sent him a letter.
We sent him a letter inviting him in.
We invited him in.
He came in.
No, he came in before.
No, not before.
Came in before.
Yeah.
Can you find, I'm quite sure we sent him a letter and said, we found this.
You're expecting him to come in.
I will feel that you are correct at this point, but I just don't want to create.
Right, we did send, I'm quite sure we sent him the results of that, understood.
My second, my other thing was the swale right there. Can they, will they be able to make that bigger so, and more?
What swale are you talking about?
Right, it's actually right there, right before the garden club.
Yeah, so we're gonna, where that structure is now, we're actually gonna make a nice bowl and have it all paved.
Perfect.
And then, but we'll want the backside to stabilize that.
Right.
That bowl, so when the water.
But that bowl will be nice and wide.
Yeah, it'll be bigger than what it is.
Because that's a pretty steep hill.
Yeah.
Great.
But the swale will be consistent, probably 4 feet wide, or 3 feet or whatever it is now. We're gonna match whatever's there now, except it'll be all broken and.
Well, it just doesn't have the back wall right now, it's all dirt.
That too.
Yes. Awesome. Thank you.
If you can't find that, we'll just draft another one. Oh, I'm sure I can find it, okay, all right. So, assuming that we did in fact notify him and invite him to come back to us, I mean, what does the board think about just the note, you know, we don't want the garden club to use it either, but we just don't want people driving onto that, into that spot over that swale, is that correct?
That's it.
Yeah. So, and I'm going to, you know, my other capacity as on the garden club board will tell them about this. And so the garden club will probably come to the board and say how they might want to, you know, try to get more parking in that front area off the road.
Right. How are we going to control the parking that happens in front of the houses on both sides? They need some place to park.
The same way that it's controlled. I mean, they think
that they're going to ruin the swale too.
It's not so much if you drive in the swale.
Right.
They're not going to use that spot.
It's when you drive over it.
Right.
You don't have the thickness, and then B, usually it's, you know, the rollers use a vibratory to get extra compaction when they're doing, you know, road. When you're doing a swale, you're not doing that because of the way it's designed. And usually on the backside of a swale, you have mold, where as in a road, you have gravel. So it's just, but if you pull in the swale, you should be sufficient as that bump. Go through it, you know, you're always pushing against that wall.
Before we go to the expense of buying up the sign, why don't we have that conversation, like, make sure we've had the conversation with the resident, and then we can discuss it regarding about the kitchen before we put a sign up.
Well, I mean, that's fine, but I mean, you know, that there are like 20 gardeners, so you want to remind them not to park there.
Right.
So they currently park.
I think I have a no parking sign at the show, if I'm mistaken.
Yeah.
They currently have two or three park, you know, they can park two or three people inside the garden club, and the garden club is looking to see whether they can, you know, come to the board and ask to like enlarge that a little bit, you know, do some more clearing. So Jeff, how is that, would you be able to do some, you know, make that entry from the road into that area
so
better?
So part of the contract is every driveway gets a 3 foot acre, and then we're back. Anything that's gravel will be back with gravel. And if it's hot top, there'll be a joint ground and there'll be a match.
So that won't be a swale, that will be a driveway like every other.
We're going through the width it is now, 3 feet.
Yeah. Okay.
And it'll be gravel.
Yeah. Okay.
But it'll be asphalt 3 feet in.
Okay. Any other questions?
Yeah, and all the intersections will be 30.
All right, so we'll look for that letter. We won't put the no parking sign up just yet. And we'll wait to see. I guess we'll continue this next week then. Kelwyn, we got an email from the Fieldsons on the road condition of Kelwyn. It's hard to tell for me.
So you're going Kelwyn, it's that dead end part where it was supposed to be Cedar Lane.
Mm.
What happened is it looks like, you know, City Summers were plows out for us. And they went in plowed this last storm, and when they picked their gear up, they sank through the asphalt. Because it's a really soft spot right there. The area that's broken is not interfering in any way, shape, or form with anybody's driveway. It's actually the very end of the road where they usually stop out of some.
Does it look awful, is that?
It's asphalt.
Yeah, I think we could pick it up or something.
Yeah, I see.
We picked it up last year where a couple pieces flaked off, but this last one we had this year, where the ground was so soft that the truck actually, I think they actually stopped.
So if we do.
We can pick the broken pieces up.
All right, if you can pick the broken pieces up, I will let them know that we're at least.
You want to see?
Pieces up.
I'm gonna watch it first.
All right, so here's, we're gonna finish Jeff's section. Then we're gonna stop for a little bit to consider a resolution that our town clerk is here to help us sign, and then we'll go to the fire department. Okay? All right, so that was Kellen. We have Pine Street, the rocks. We got an email from the Wittens about.
So on Pine Street, in the area of, I believe it's 18, there's a hill that comes down, the water washes the shoulder out all the time. I've tried 3/4 inch gravel, 3 inch gravel. And just the way the road slopes and pitch, it goes to that side of the road, which deteriorates the side of the road. So we put a small amount of 2 inch, I call it erosion stuff, which therefore we haven't had any trouble since. But when you plow this last storm where everything was soft, it may have bumped a little bit, moved the rocks, and so on and so forth.
Are they, is there a way to determine whether any of these rocks were pushed onto their property as opposed to their property without a town right of way as opposed to our right of way?
So Hoyle and Tanner got back to me today, and that road varies from 50 foot to a 40 foot right away throughout the certain parts of the road. He wasn't sure what part was what, because the person that actually does that was not in today. But the records show that the road does vary 40 to 50 foot all the way up through from Crown Street to Main, I guess it's called Silver Street.
Worst case scenario, measured at 40. That's where that is. I drove by it, and it looked like it was in the.
I drove by it, it's more than ditch line.
And what they may consider they're long, so. But I didn't measure it, so.
Well, can you measure 40 feet and maybe put a flag and then take another picture? See?
Sure, if they let me. Yeah.
Well, I mean, it's the right of, you know, if the right of way is at least 40 feet, then, I mean, does the board have any other thoughts or on this?
No, we have the New England once again.
Yeah, exactly.
Me and my neighbors were just out moving the rocks back to the.
Do you want to just write a letter saying we're not
responsible?
I don't know that we're not responsible, so I don't want to say that, because I'm not sure. We can just say that. We can ask them or just say that the town feels that, you know, we don't have the resources to manage this. But I don't know that we're not responsible. If somebody can tell me that, beyond a shadow of a doubt, I'd be happy to say that.
So why don't we go out and measure it? We measure that at the same time we measure where Burnell's here.
Okay. That sounds good. Thank you. Volvo backhoe, is there anything new to say? Cleaning at the highway department? I'd like to table this until maybe later in the year so we can figure out if there's any, what our money situation is.
What, the old highway department?
No, this is a request that we had from you to provide janitorial services.
No, I'm not from
that. Did that come from you?
Oh, the bathroom. Yeah.
Recycling equipment proposals, I think we're going to at least look at that later on in the meeting, so I'm just going to let you know we'll do it just yet. Anything else for Jeff?
Yeah, there's a couple of things in my folder. Nick still hasn't sent us a snowfall.
No, we reached out to him several times and they have not gotten back to me. I don't know if they've gotten back to Caroline.
That's nice of them.
Good for our cash flow.
Yes, thank you, Nick. And two purchase orders for.
That's stormwater, and I'm happy to speak to that when we get to that.
Thank you, but there was no who it went to.
You're right.
So I wasn't sure if it was Jeff's or not.
Okay, I'll leave it in
the folder.
Super, we can talk about that later. All right, so I think we're good with Jeff. Hi. How did you come in?
I, just a few minutes ago, I just popped in to get that shoreline permit by notification sign. I can, I'll wait until there's a break, since.
This, are we through with Jeff? Okay, thank you, Jeff. So we'll do the resolution, just a minute, this is really, really quick.
Perfect.
I don't understand, I have set, what do I do, did I keep setting wrong one?
It might be the wetlands permit by notification, so that's the cover letter or the actual document. The rest of this is just a backup that Deb gave me, so no one did sign it.
So this is a short, can you just explain to the, just briefly to the boards?
So there's two applications that are necessary for the lower mill outfall project. One of them is the actual wetlands application, and that is, they're both permit by notifications, meaning they're a less involved process, you just file a form, and by filing it, you're basically getting the permit. What I think was signed before was the wetlands permit, this is the shoreline permit by notification.
I thought that that's the one, I believed it.
I told them, I said, you know what, I'll swing by on my way home, no problem.
Beautiful.
I'll sign.
It looks like the one I did too, but whatever.
They all.
All right, so board, I'm gonna sign the shoreline.
Permit by notification. For the lower mill.
For the lower mill. Okay. And as long as you're here, we could say that Aaron reached out to the North Country, who were concerned about our work schedule and other things.
Yes.
And so it looks like, you know, we're gonna be able to manage their concerns and our construction concerns.
Yeah, the big concern is that they're taking room hours or days on Thursday from Sunday, so we're gonna do what we can to either not work at all on those days or limit work during those days to areas that don't block their outdoor area and their loading dock, which is very doable.
So thank you for that.
Yeah, there's other things that I summarized, a little stuff that we're gonna obviously take care of during construction.
I hope you were able to provide some business to them as well.
A little bit, yes. Want some good recommendations from you on what to try.
Fire starter.
Yeah, it was delicious. I might have brought some out, and it might be gone already. Great.
Thank you so much, Aaron. By the way, that was Aaron the Chance of Quail Tanner, yes.
Anything else?
I think we're okay. We're about to talk about the USDA loan application, so.
Perfect time to leave then.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, so I think we're very close to being able to go public, because here we are talking about it, so I guess so. So the USDA is granting us a loan application for the culvert project to the tune of $379,459. It's about $6,000 less than the $385,000 that the town authorized us for, and it's only because of how the budgets fell in place. So here's the letter of, here's the letter of acceptance from them. And here's the loan resolution that this board has to consider. And, you know, not hearing anything that says we shouldn't, I'm gonna read it out loud, so I'm gonna ask you for your patience while I do that. And our town clerk is here to notarize our signatures. All right, this is a loan resolution. And at the end, I'll ask one of us, actually you, I will ask you to move to adopt this, okay? Right. I'm going to read the loan resolution. A resolution of the Select Board of the Town of Rollinsford, New Hampshire, authorizing and providing for the incurrence of indebtedness for the purpose of providing a portion of the cost of acquiring, constructing, enlarging, improving, and or extending its culverts and storm drain repair to serve an area lawfully within its jurisdiction to serve. Whereas it is necessary for the town of Rollinsford, New Hampshire, hereinafter called the association, to raise a portion of the cost of such undertaking by issuance of its bonds in the principal amount of $379,459.00, pursuant to the provisions of New Hampshire statutes annotated. And whereas the association intends to obtain assistance from the United States Department of Agriculture, herein called the government, acting under the provisions of the Consolidated Farm and Rural Development Act, 7 U.S.C. 1921 et sequentia, in the planning, financing, and supervision of such undertaking and the purchasing of bonds lawfully issued in the event that no other acceptable purchaser for such bonds is found by the association. Now therefore, in consideration of the premises of the association, hereby resolves, number one, to have prepared on its behalf and to adopt an ordinance or resolution for the issuance of its bonds containing such items and in such forms as are required by state statutes and as are agreeable and acceptance and acceptable to the government. Two, to refinance the unpaid balance in whole or in part of its bonds upon the request of the government, if at any time it shall appear to the government that the association is able to refine its bonds by obtaining a loan for such purposes from responsible cooperative or private sources at reasonable rates and terms for loans for similar purposes and periods of time as required by Section 333C of said Consolidated Farm and Rural Development Act, 7 U.S.C. 1983C. Number three, to provide for, execute, and comply with Form RD-400-4 Assurance Agreement and Form RD-400-1 Equal Opportunity Agreement. By the way, I have another copy.
Did I do it right?
Okay, just wanted to make two. Sorry, was I?
Equal Opportunity.
Okay, so we have to comply with Form RD-404 Assurance Agreement and Form RD-401 Equal Opportunity Agreement, including an Equal Opportunity Clause, which clauses to be incorporated in or attached as a rider to each construction contract and subcontract involving in excess of $10,000. Number four, to indemnify the government for any payments made or losses suffered by the government on behalf of the association. Such indemnification shall be payable from the same source of funds pledged to pay the bonds or any other legally permissible source. Number five, that upon default in the payments of any principal and accrued interest on the bonds or in the performance of any covenant or agreement contained herein or in the instruments intended incident to making or insuring the loan, the government at its option may A, declare the entire principal amount then outstanding and accrued interest immediately due and payable, B, for the account of the association payable from the source of funds pledged to pay the bonds or any other legally permissible source, incur and pay reasonable expenses for repair, maintenance and operation of the facility, and such other reasonable expenses as may be necessary to cure the cause of default, and or C, take possession of the facility, repair, maintain, and operate and rent it. Default under the provisions of this resolution or any instrument incident to the making or insuring of the loan may be construed by the government to constitute default under any other instrument held by the government and executed or assumed by the association. And default under any such instrument may be construed by the government to constitute default hereunder. Number six, not to sell, transfer, lease, or otherwise encumber the facility or any portion thereof or interest therein or permit others to do so without the prior written consent of the government. Number seven, not to defease the bonds or to borrow money, enter into any contract or agreement, or otherwise incur any liabilities for any purpose in connection with the facility, exclusive of normal maintenance, without the prior written consent of the government, if such undertaking would involve the source of funds pledged to pay the bonds. Eight, to place the proceeds of the bonds on deposit in an account and in a manner approved by the government. Funds may be deposited in institutions insured by the state or federal government, or invested in readily marketable securities backed by the full faith and credit of the United States. Any income from these accounts will be considered as revenues of the system. Number nine, to comply with all applicable state and federal laws and regulations and to continually operate and maintain the facility in good condition. Number 10, to provide for the receipt of adequate revenues to meet the requirements of debt service, operation and maintenance, and the establishment of adequate reserves. Revenue accumulated over and above that needed to pay operating and maintenance, debt service, and reserves may only be retained or used to make prepayments on the loan. Revenues cannot be used to pay any expenses which are not directly incurred for the facility financed by USDA. No free service or use of the facility will be permitted. Number 11, to acquire and maintain such insurance and fidelity bond coverage as may be required by the government. 12, to establish and maintain such books and records relating to the operation of the facility and its financial affairs, and to provide for the required audit thereof as required by the government, to provide the government a copy of each such audit without its request, and to forward to the government such additional information and reports as it may from time to time require. Number 13, to provide the government at all reasonable times access to all books and records relating to the facility and access to the property, of the system so that the government may ascertain that the association is complying with the provisions hereof and of the instruments incident to making or insuring of a loan, to the making or insuring of a loan. Number 14, that if the government requires that a reserve account be established, disbursements from that account or accounts may be used when necessary for payments due on the bond if sufficient funds are not otherwise available and prior approval of the government is obtained. Also, with the prior written approval of the government, funds may be withdrawn and used for such things as emergency maintenance, extensions to facilities, and replacement of short-lived assets. Number 15, to provide adequate service to all persons within the service area who can feasibly and legally be served and to obtain USDA's concurrence prior to refusing new or adequate services to such persons. Upon failure to provide services which are feasible and legal, such person shall have a direct right of action against the Association of Public Body. Number 16, to comply with the measures identified in the government's environmental impact analysis for this facility for the purpose of avoiding or reducing the adverse environmental impacts of the facility's construction or operation. I will read item number 17, but it relates to a grant, and this is, we're not filling this out, so there's no grant involved. To accept a grant in the amount of not to exceed, and it's blank. So that is not applicable. That's it for the terms. There's one final paragraph. The provisions hereof and of the provisions of all instruments incident to the making or the insuring of the loan, unless otherwise specifically provided by the terms of such instruments, shall be binding upon the association as long as the bonds are held or insured by the government or assignee. The provisions of section 6 through 17 hereof may be provided for in more specific detail in the bond resolution or ordinance. To the extent that the provisions contained in such bond resolution or ordinance should be found to be inconsistent with the provisions hereof, these provisions shall be construed as controlling between the association and the government or assignee. Before I ask you to move this, I'll just make a couple of clarifying comments. The references to facility don't really pertain to us because it's not a facility. So, you know, we're not going to be in the position of trying to sell these culprits to anybody, for example, because they're not of that nature. There are no service fees associated with them. So those are the standard resolution. And otherwise, it pretty much says, you know, you're going to pay us back. And at some point in time, if interest rates go crazy or kaflooey, you know, they could ask us to go search for another bond or another, you know, at some point. They rarely do that. I'm just saying that is part of this resolution. And just also, while it's not here, this is a 30-year note at 2.75% interest.
Yeah, so the actual interest rate will be, right now it's at 2.75 till July 1st. The actual interest rate will be lower of the interest rate in effect at the time of loan obligation or loan closing.
Yeah,
so I was going to say that into the motion.
No, because this is where this particular resolution that we're needing to move and sign and have our town clerk attest to. So, would you like to?
Sure. Move to adopt the USDA loan resolution bond in the amount of $379,459.09 for a term of 30 years.
I will second. And I'm going to ask for, you know, yays and nays, and we're going to count you, Michael, because we still feel very strongly that you are a valid member of the board.
I agree.
So, yes. All right. So, how many, I'll ask for the yay votes on this resolution. All in favor say yes. Like I said, roll call tonight. Michael?
Yes.
Jody?
Yes.
Suzanne? Yes. There are no nays. We have three yeses. Nobody absent. Shall we sign this? Yes, we shall. Okay. And we're going to do it in duplicate. So, let's see.
No.
And you have your seal, too?
I do.
Okay. So, let's see. The witness whereof the select board. Of the town of Bronson, New Hampshire, has duly adopted this resolution and caused it to be executed by the officers below in duplicate on this 17th day.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
I'm sorry.
April. And there are three yeas. ready, I'll start signing the other one. And when we actually close, like October, November, we will have something else to sign.
Thank you.
Pardon? No, you had to be the one who said yes, but otherwise I'm, it authorizes me to sign it, but I need your vote to authorize it. Yes. So three yays, zero nays, zero absent.
Is that one ready?
Yes, it is. Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't hear you move up.
We're also not anticipating sort of like the separate accounts and this and that, because really what will happen is that we'll pay this out as we go along. It's going to be done at the end of, sometime in the fall. And so we'll just get the reimbursable money for the...
And that's when you sign at closing, so I'm just keeping it with that.
Yes, let's put that, the two... I'll keep one of these originals in this folder. Is that one? Okay.
Yep.
And we'll send the other one off to the USDA. And then we'll keep these, well, the two, yes, I'll keep them close. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Madam Town Clerk, we appreciate you coming in.
Peace soup on the stove.
All right. Enjoy.
Fort Burns.
And I wonder if you'll lock this every Tuesday when I try to open that door.
Tuesday?
So, one out of three. I'll give an update. I'll give an update later on. Chief Rutherford.
Short and sweet, one piece of business.
You're done, right?
I just have one.
Go ahead, go.
You have a non-public?
But these guys can do their thing and then let's go ahead.
All right.
One purchase order, two surveys. It's still one of those annual dues things. Purchase order number 1136, and it is to the Seacoast Technical Assistance Response. It's the STAR team, basically. Basically, it's our annual dues for our hazard. So we have an incident down, and our potential is as high as anybody else with the train and whatnot. So it's for that entity, and it's for a total of $604. $604, yeah, for our annual 2017 dues.
We'll purchase order number 1136 of the Seacoast Technical Assistance Response Team for our 2017 annual membership dues.
$604. Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
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 Anybody understands what that is? Okay. I mean, if we had an incident, but obviously we're not going to be able to handle it on our own. So that is basically the regional response to all our SVPs and their equipment on time. And just make the call. And that's the team. It's based on a combination. Most of the stuff's unfortunate, but it's based on a Portsmouth Exeter and Dover. About a 40-member team. They can try and help us alleviate whatever we need to do. And our backup team is the shipyard, which is the cost for their response. So that's how we cover those issues. Hopefully never need them.
Absolutely, always.
Absolutely. Well, we have participated as a team over at the shipyard most recently, right?
We sent our...
It goes back and forth.
Yeah, exactly. This is a lot like the same as mutual aid kind of thing. That's what we've been doing all week. We've been to six other communities in the last week, so it's been rather busy over the prior few. So, and this falls along the same lines, and mutually, so, yes, we went to the shipyard, I don't know, 4 or 5 years ago, for the subway, and, so it all, and it goes around and comes around, so.
So, well, as long as you're here, I mean, one update is that GNC is going to review.
19th, right?
Yes, so that's this week.
It's 2 days from now.
Yeah, the Derrick Grant, the final hurdle on the Derrick Grant, so.
And then it goes to the governor's desk, correct?
And that's it, it's governor, this is governor and council, so this is it. There's no other hurdle.
I had lunch where the, looks like the one speed today, actually, and he seemed to think there's any problems, so.
Good.
And contacted, I have Homeland Security, back in the state, same way, as he mentioned, so the governor, but conversations with him, and he says, no, issues with our side.
So the money comes from the feds, and it's already in place, so it's passed through, so, but, you know, until you get the final signature.
Then you do what you're doing right there, and I understand.
Yeah, so.
Yeah, and like I said, well, last week, we went through and signed the truck, and talking with Jerry McKay again, basically, we're gonna get monthly updates on the construction of the truck. There's gonna be pictures and all that stuff, which will be coming in, so I'll bring them in and share them with you, so you can see the progress of how that project is going also, so. That's in pipeline now.
All right, thank you.
Anything else for me? Good.
Thanks, even everybody else, thanks, we're busy.
We've been everybody else's town the last week, it's been crazy, but of course, but.
North Burwick.
Over twice, we spent 6 hours in North Burwick, we were in South Burwick the other day, so.
What's they say?
Go, go, go. No, it's good, it's the guys, it's us.
Caroline, you're not here for long?
No, I'm listening.
Okay, that's fine, okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. So you want, I'm sorry, so you want to talk to us about in a non-public, is that? For what?
I'm moving on non-public session, spoken to the person.
Second.
All right, roll call, Mike. Jody?
Yes.
Suzanne, yes.
No.
And I got something from Miss Dora.
Yep, we're now back in session. We're back in session, thank you.
Oh, excuse me.
So, in actuality, we need not have gone into non-public, so I'm gonna say exactly what happened at this meeting, so that it's completely public. And we've provided, you know, some guidance about what, when we do need to go into non-public. So what the borough agent has asked is permission to advertise for additional help for the highway department in the road labor line that we have budgeted at $50,800. So he is going to work with Caroline and put an ad in. Some of the folks that he has had who have been paid from that line have had changes in their own employment status and the like, and are no longer quite as available. So we have given him the okay to post. And we've gone over the budget amount, which is $15,800 in all. And I think you're gonna advertise it at $1,435. So that's pretty much what went on in that session. Okay, so we're going to continue on. We know what the department heads. So we're going to town administration. Appointments, we have appointed John Krabs, we're just waiting for like this little contract statement.
Line of my hand.
Oh, I'm so sorry, yes, we should work on that even though the police are not here. Yes, thank you, Michael, I'm glad you're not completely blind. So one of the jobs that are, a task that's part of the timeline that was put in place for the police space needs project is to appoint members to this committee. And so we asked for people to let us know before, I think today is the deadline. And Caroline sent us an email, correct?
They did.
And the, yes, so, let's see.
It was sent today?
It was sent today, police department space needs, okay. So here are the people who have volunteered to be on the space needs committee. Howard Hammond, Kim St. Hilaire, Denise Knowles, Bill Irwin, and Charlie Putnam, depending on how much work is involved. So, to we have those folks. We have both of you, I think, have expressed interest in serving on this. Is that, do I remember that correctly?
I think only one of us, if Jody wants to do it, that's fine. I'm not straight at work until July, so if you want to do it, I'm fine with it, I'm not gonna.
Can we flip-flop as we go along?
I would say that it's better to have a committed board member.
Okay.
And to just have somebody there in, you know, as a backup in case.
If you've got other, you know, things you have to do.
Yeah.
I'll do it.
Are you also pretty much?
I want to.
I'll do it, don't worry.
Okay, so you're okay then, so we'll have Michael.
I'll make it work.
So you can also be sort of like the plan, any sort of go-between between that committee and the planning board to any extent that we need that. Okay, so.
Maybe soft.
Police, we wanted.
Well, we need Chief Ducharme. I don't know whether he, did he request also the lieutenant or is he?
Yeah, he and lieutenant, but then you had mentioned you wanted a retired police.
Well, you get that with Bill again, somewhat retired.
And then you wanted a budget committee.
Kim.
Well, we've got, so Kim, Denise, and Bill are also budget committee. Not that they are, you know, the budget committee isn't meeting until sometime next week, I think, or whatever. But nonetheless, either any of those three, to the extent that they serve, could end up being the budget committee rep.
So Kim, Bill, Howard, Denise, and what, there was a fifth?
It was Charlie Turner, but he says depending upon how much work is involved. So I don't know how to respond to that. It's gonna be pretty intense at this beginning part, I think. It's big.
No. Seven, if you exclude Charlie, so could we say two from the police staff, right? The lieutenant and the chief.
Kim, Denise, Bill. That's good.
Okay. You can include Charlie, and if you can't do it, you can't do it, I mean.
Well, I love Charlie, but here's my devil's advocate. He's the moderator. When this goes to the public, he's gonna be moderating that meeting. Is there any?
No, I don't.
No problem with that.
Okay.
Just throwing.
Yeah, no, I appreciate that. You never know. But so you mean like a bond warrant when it comes to town?
Yeah, anything like that. Like he's gonna be moderating it and presenting it and.
He won't be presenting it.
You don't know.
He won't be presenting.
So these folks are purely advisory, so it's.
They're not having any real responsible duties, or I mean, they're just there to make essentially a recommendation to the board.
Yeah.
All right, so then let's just try it. So is the board suggesting then that we appoint?
Oh, just a second. So when is the budget committee meeting again? Next week, you said?
26th.
26th, so it's 2 weeks?
Yes, but we can, I feel quite sure, though I can't speak for the budget committee, I feel quite sure that the budget committee will be happy to.
A week from Wednesday.
Fair enough. I don't want to step on anyone's toes.
No, understood. So none of these three will be the actual appointed budget committee member, but could be. And so we'll assume that will happen unless.
It'd be helpful if one of them were, I don't think so. It shouldn't get too much of a number, but.
So far, I have as appointees, Mike Rolo as ex officio from the board, Chief Ducharme and Lieutenant Yuraskovich, Howard Hammond, Kim Sandler, Denise Knowles, Bill Irving, and Charlie Putnam.
So moved.
I have a second. Any further discussion?
Is there anyone else we want to have? There's no other, not that your individual names, but any other professions we're not thinking of that could add to the conversation?
Well, the committee could always reach out in a subcommittee sort of level if it, you know, like Howard, who's in the building trades, can maybe bring somebody else in if we need that.
I wasn't thinking more of a subspecialty of the building trades, but, and I'm not sure if there is something else. I just, before we finalize it, just.
We can always appoint.
Sure, why not?
All right, so I've got the motion, I've got the second. I will call the question. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Did you get the name, Selma?
I did.
All right, thank you.
Thank you all the residents that volunteered.
Yes. I can email all of these, and I will, except for Howard. I don't know if there's an email for Howard. So we'll have Caroline call him or something. we've already, oh yeah, we had to go back because we ignored that. Now I'm on town administration, planning board consultant. We hired John Krebs. He is our planning board consultant. We're just waiting for a contract, so that's why it remains on the agenda. Library trustees, we appointed the alternates, and we can go over that. ZBA, status of appointment. So based on the board's meeting last week, I did send a follow-up to Joe Coed, who's currently serving as chair of the ZBA, to notify him that as far as we had appointed as a full voting member of the ZBA, John Hinsman. And that if he had any confusion about that, please come and see us. I don't see him here tonight. I'll assume that everything is now okay.
He usually responds to me an email.
He does.
So I mean, it's not like he gets it, so he responds.
He does get email.
Right.
So I did do that. Budget one, I sent out the report to the board that I will be sending out to the budget committee later this week. There was nothing particularly interesting other than the highway department, which, you know, we spent a lot of money on the winter this year, so they are sort of more than 25% of their budget. And we'll take a look at what it looks like next quarter, and if so, we'll move some of the contingency budget to some of these lines, because we'll have to get ready for winter, you know, November, December. So, but at this moment, we don't need to, I don't think, to do anything like that. There are FY16 expenses that I've sequestered.
Yes.
They still come out of their report, but I yanked them out of their report and put them at the bottom. This is the purchase order for the civil works engineers. And the other thing is, right now, there are Hoyle Tanner expenses and professional services that will be transferred to the appropriate, to the appropriate bond points. Pardon? I don't know.
Hey, Joe.
Hi, Joe. Come on up. We were just talking about you.
Oh, you were?
Yes, I said we sent you an email.
Yes, I did.
Yes.
I got it today.
Yeah.
Oh. So I never got that notification you said you gave me.
Huh. We had a reply from you. We had a reply that said you didn't know him.
No. No, I didn't know him at all.
Right. So
I got to meet him till that evening.
So we did appoint him.
Okay, I get that.
Good. All right.
And the reason I was asking why wasn't I made aware that there was a vacancy?
We told you also in January, I sent an email to all the board chairs that said, here are the vacancies that are coming up in your boards or commissions. So I sent it to you and Al Dion and Pat Macklin.
And I came here.
Yeah, you came.
I think the next week you had an emergency to that.
Yeah, I was not there.
And we took that through. And those were both in the town book.
What's his name?
Well, that doesn't appoint them. Those were your recommendations.
Right.
As chair at the time.
Right.
Yes.
Right.
But
I was inside. Yeah, my.
Mr.
That was the end of the communications.
So
I had a question about Mr. Moore.
That's what Moore, I've been doing last night.
Dennis Moore, because we hadn't seen him.
Right.
You know, I was using Paul Kazalk, and he's been attending a lot of the meetings. So I was wondering, what's the purpose or the role of an alternate? I would have suggested that we move the alternate into a field vacancy.
Well, the board thought, when we talked about this, the board thought that it would be helpful to have a crossover representative from the planning board, which is something that's been recommended by the Municipal Association, for example. So we used the opportunity to appoint John Hinsman, who serves on the planning board, to be a full member. And Paul Kazalt remains an alternate, as does, I think, Gary, is it Gary Fieldson?
Fieldson, yes.
Yeah, Gary we don't see too much, but Paul has been very faithful. Yeah. And as a matter of fact, I've had some problems because he's a part of the planning board in some ways.
Who is Paul?
And this is not a planning board. It's a board of appeals. We're an adjunct to the Superior Court. You understand that. And I finally got him organized. I guess pretty well. He understands that. But it's not something new. This particular case that we had, in fact, it's coming up again in a couple of weeks. We could have just thrown it out. In fact, when he approached me back in December, a long time ago, it was really Mickey Mouse project, you know.
That one'd be 350 feet down. So, and we had that authority too. We can, so I told him the time's gonna cost you a bit of money, get yourself a designer, an architect, get a survey, because we need specifications. Well, that's not required by the planning board. With us, it is required. Because we are a judicial body. So you can't take any chances. Otherwise, we end up with the same problems that we had when the Mrs. Stockdale sold the property. And the two nephews inherited that. They sold it, and eventually, they sold it to a developer. I think in the first few years, we had at least three, maybe four cases that had to come to us because the developer did not follow the plans and yet superseded the boundaries. And one day, as a matter of fact, he went to the post office in tears because the property, it's something like, they went to the last minute, I guess, like we all do, I guess, in certain things. So we don't want that to happen. So I, then he was vacant. He didn't want to spend that kind of money, apparently. But I heard from him again a couple of weeks ago. And now he's back. Well, we held a meeting about 2 weeks ago here, and we gave him a chance. We told him to go back and get us. I did the next meeting, the next hearing we made it for. We could have just told him, you know, it's going to be defeated, plain and simple. The reason I did, I put Paul Gasol that night, because we had 6 members here. And I was involved with this gentleman in a way. I don't want to go over the boundary. I mean, there's legal entanglements here. But I spoke to him about 2 days, or 3 days, before he came to the house. And I told him, no, you got to prove your hardship. And you're going to be, you're appealing a decision made to Section 7. You didn't even know that. I can't be the attorney for the defendant.
Well, I appreciate that, Joe. We have to be really, really careful, right? The zoning board has to be careful, and we have to make sure that you all are not meeting with the applicant.
Yeah, and no intimidation from anybody.
Right. So it's probably best, you know, not to meet with them, because what we need to make sure is that other folks who might be affected by the ruling of the ZPA then don't go and try to sue the town because someone has been talking to the applicant.
That's right. But if you go through the thick chapter that comes from the state with the history of zoning boards, they give a lot of latitude. As a matter of fact, one of my more conservative members that evening seemed to be telling him, you know, take this back and get it done. And his remarks were more or less, we're not going to vote on it tonight, we're going to delay it, which we did. Mm-hmm. And I'm getting together with Sarah, and I think it's going to be May the 4th right now, when the date's available for her. And I hopefully Lydia will still be around those days. You know, I mean, I have a lot of problems with my friend.
Sorry.
But that's nothing to do with my responsibilities here. But after 37 years, we're pretty close. Mm-hmm. So anyway, Paul has really got involved. He's even taken pictures of that property, I understand.
He's a wonderful committee member. He also serves on the stormwater committee.
He has to be gaveled down once in a while. But that's all right, I can do that. And I think, in fact, I did the same thing with, I think, Mr. Rowe one time when you came to the planning board.
Mr. Rowe?
Oh, yes, I admit, I had him participate, but no vote the first time.
Yes. I wasn't gaveled down, I didn't vote.
Oh, I see.
I think really wasn't
gaveled. I was an alternate at one time.
Right. So,
clear that up right now.
Thank you.
And Mr. Jansen used to come in almost every hearing, because then I do bring a gavel with me. Because of that hearing, you need a gavel. And, you know, he meant well, but there's a certain period of time where we have to tape everything. It's judicial. So this next meeting, May the 4th, I will probably, I hate to change the membership, unless there's a reason for that hearing.
Well, Joe, I mean, he's been appointed. John Hinsman has been appointed as the full CBA board member. I don't know how you can not see him.
Well, because I've never seen him at a hearing. And we are separate body from the planning board.
Yes, but he is, we have appointed him to the Zoning Board of Adjustments.
Right.
He happens to be a planning board member as well, but we appointed him to fill the term on the Zoning Board of Adjustments. So I'm saying, I don't know how you could not seat him. is the board's.
Well, then I may excuse myself, I'll run the meeting and not vote, if everybody shows up. You know, for years, I was crying about not having membership. And with my pleas at the town meetings, now we have pretty good membership, actually.
That's a good thing.
And they're all different bodies, they're all different-minded. It's like the old days, you know, there's no way in the world you could change Obed Vial's mind, or Eddie Kravinsky's mind, or Fred Green's mind, and who are individuals. Sonny Foss, I mean, you know, these people, they vote their mind, and they understand that there's no precedence with the zoning board. Every case is an individual case. This particular gentleman, I was kind of surprised, because we do have the opportunity to not have to accept professional plans, designs. The statutes, not statutes, but the guidelines do allow us that. Unless in cases we feel that it isn't that important. In this particular instance, it may not be, because there's quite a bit of property out there.
Well, I'm not familiar with the case, and I don't need to be familiar with it, and the board doesn't need to be familiar with the case, but we would appreciate your seating, Mr. Hinsman.
Even though he didn't understand what the procedures were of the Board of Appeals.
He's a full member. Everybody starts out new.
Is that fair to the community?
I don't know how else to say this, we've appointed him, Joe.
He didn't seem to be offended, the fact he participated. But if you require, and you're not going to intimidate me anyway, I mean, I think you know that by now. I'll think it over.
We're not trying to intimidate. We're trying to say, though, that he is the board's appointee.
I understand.
And the board has the right to appoint the membership of the Zoning Board of Adjustments.
Yes, you have.
And so we have done that.
Yeah.
That's the board's wish.
I'd like to get some cooperation. If there's a vacancy, I'd like to be made aware of it. I'm going to be the chairman.
We made you aware of it, Joe. We sent out in January notices to all the board chairs. These are the vacancies that you have. Please, if you want to make a recommendation, please make a recommendation. I was not there, you came.
I agree.
Dennis Moore has not been to any 2016 Zoning Board of Adjustment.
You're right.
And so we reappointed Ron Chabot, who was one of your recommended ones, and we appointed John Hinsman as to fill that position. That's the board's appointee.
Yeah, I understand that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I just want to make sure I wasn't playing games with you. I was never informed, I really was.
I can send you the emails again.
Why don't you? Because I had problems. I've had burn wherever my viewers, just so I can cover myself up.
Sure, I'd be happy to send you the emails
okay.
again.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thanks for coming on, Joe. Have a safe walk across the street.
It was a long ride.
Good night.
See ya.
Good night, Joe.
Good night, Joe.
Okay. That was quite topical, timely.
Yeah.
Were we finished with the 4-1 report?
Yes.
Do you have any questions? I sent you the link. Voting on planning break schedule.
The call last week, it didn't make it off for some reason. The planning board has made recommendations as to changes to the fee schedule and would like the approval of the select board. I recall it was changes to the fee to send out registered mail or certified mail rather to abutters and advertising costs.
Do we have them? We're voting on them. Do we have the detail?
Is it in the?
Is it? I don't know. Is it
somewhere? Wouldn't be in my folder. It would be in one.
Do you have anything like that?
I
need something to vote on.
$10 for mail and $250 for advertising, but if it's not there, then I agree we shouldn't be voting on it unless you have a question.
Was it an email?
I truly don't know.
I can check.
I've ever seen it this morning.
Nothing's really popping up in my email, which doesn't mean it isn't there.
I was traveling all day, so I didn't check email, so I apologize.
So, I'll check with Caroline. Do you think would she have this? Was this an action of the planning board or?
Yes.
Okay, so it's.
At a public hearing last December.
So, can Sarah, so then the minutes? All right, so we can, I'll ask Sarah.
My understanding is Sarah was forwarding it to Caroline. It would be in the folder, so.
Let me see if I had something from Sarah. First thing that pops up is November 1st, so.
I don't think so.
So, I'll just make a note, we'll have to postpone it a week.
Yeah, I don't disagree with you.
Okay. So we're looking for the recommendations for fee increases. Okay, so we'll table that. Review of legal priorities, I want us to table this too, but maybe next week, what I'd like us to do is review all the things that are sort of in the pipeline and maybe prioritize and maybe, you know, postpone or whatever, because things are starting to pile up, I guess, so. I mean, we're still fine, but I think it's good for us to maybe take stock and see what's on the list and make sure we're absolutely clear about what we want people to be working on. Stormwater committee, I met last week and went over with them the 27 work that we budgeted, and they did recommend that we put forward two purchase orders to the board. And they're both two public water system services, which is Scott and Ben's company. And I think Jody is on the hunt for that.
Public water what systems?
PWSS, Public Water System Services.
System Services.
Yes. So one is, and I'll ask Jody to move it if she would like, one is to Public Water Systems for their annual testing. We did the first annual testing last week. And so it'll be one purchase order that will cover spring testing and fall testing. So it'll be three outflows twice a year, so that's at $120 a piece, so that's for a total of $720. So,
okay. Jody, what line is coming
up? Stormwater management under the highway department.
Thank you. So do you want me?
Yeah, it should be there. Yeah, yes, you can do that. Yeah. Are you in there? Are you looking it up? Should be. Does it have a real number?
Yes, it does.
Oh,
thank you.
Okay. Sometimes these new ones have 99999. And then I'll talk
the same
about
one?
No, I'll talk about this one. Let's do this one. And I'll say what the next one does.
Okay. Move to accept purchase order 1174 to PWWS.
PWSS.
PWSS. Six.
Sorry.
Seven Falls River outflow testing, three in the spring, three in the fall, at $120 each for a total of $720.
Second. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Well, why don't you move this one and then I'll talk about it? Unless there isn't enough there.
Is there?
Let me talk about it.
Code?
Yes, it is the same code. Here, I'll talk about it. So this is another one. I'll let you fill it out. This is another one to Public Water System Services. And this is purchase order will result in installing some check dams in Stockdale Circle along a part it's a really deep ditch that's eroding someone's side lawn and flows into Partridge Lane. So we don't know really the source of the silt that's flowing down and eroding. And so the check dams are not a permanent sort of a installation. They're to provide some diagnostic and also to help with the erosion, but it's mostly to provide some diagnostics. So the Stormwater Committee does recommend that we do this, and it has been budgeted.
All right, move to accept purchase order 1175, PWSS.
Thank you.
So, thank you for correcting. For 10 dams, for 10 installations of check dams in Stockdale Circle runoff ditches at $60 a piece for a total of $600.
I'll call the question just a minute. I also, so I was speaking to Scott McLean and asked him, do you want us to send out letters or whatever? He says he'll just knock on doors if he has to walk on somebody's lawn to go put the check dam. So, is the board okay with that?
What, does he have like an official shirt to wear?
He would have his PWSS shirt.
Should we at least send out an email saying that somebody's going to be coming?
Yeah, I would prefer that, actually, yes. Let's do that.
Because in this day and age.
Yeah, absolutely.
PWSS means nothing to me.
Yes.
Well, does now.
Yes.
That's
a good idea.
Since we just had Avatar coming.
Yeah, exactly.
I agree.
Very good. Okay. All right, I'm ready to call a question. All those in favor of this PO for $600, say aye.
Aye.
Some updates on our various projects, the projects themselves, the financing associated with them, blah, blah, blah. So the culvert process project, we received the loan, and they have a PR person, they being USDA, Rural Services or Rural Community Services. And so unless the board has some objection, they can help us put together some PR to notify the community.
An extra cost?
No.
Okay.
No cost. Understood. No cost. good question. So I will put that in place then. I will say, yeah, could you help us? Easements. So we did have a meeting last Friday, and in fact we worked with the two of us who thought that the property owner's privacy needed to be honored were correct. Boyle Tanner and their property person, the discussions with the property owners are private. However, what's public, and this is what we didn't have ahead of time, but I will announce it, is the initial offer, and we just, you know, the timing happened not in the best possible way. So I will say we got a letter from Avatar early Friday morning, where Avatar said, he's looked at the easements, he's looked at the properties, and Avatar felt that there was no inherent cost to the homeowner, that we were, if anything, we were going to improve the property rather than take a hit. So he thought we needed to offer nothing. So Hoyle Tanner, however, says we need to have some minimal offers. And so what we offered was either $250, which was the minimum for the smaller easement requests, and $500 for the larger ones. There were two that were, I think, over 2,000 square feet. So those were our opening things. And that, you know, would have been nice if we could have made that public ahead of time. That's the public piece. The individual homeowner's response to that is not public until they sign it. So we had, there are six easements involved. Two on Pine, the rest are Willie. On Willie Street, the school just signed a temporary construction easement, so we're all set there. Mr. Degnon agreed to the offer. He was a $500 offer. He agreed to that. The easement itself has to be signed by both him and his wife is not available. So he should be bringing that to us this week. There are two others there. One was Morganelli, and Hoyle Tanner went out and looked at his property with him, and he's still thinking about it. And then Robinson, and Robinson is coming in tomorrow at 4:00, so we'll make them the $250 offer. So that's Willie. Pine Street, Mrs. Adams, Kate Adams came in and signed the easement, accepted the offer, so that's complete. And the other easement that we need there is St. Laurent, who does not live in town. It's an undeveloped lot. And so we're in contact with them and hope that we can get him to commit. So that's where the easements are. Any questions or comments on that? We've done the resolution, reviewed some of the paperwork, talked about the announcement and the PR. There are a couple of things that we need to work on. One is we need to have a conflict of interest policy, and that's further down on the list. I've given us a draft to look at. We also need to implement a drug-free workplace, and which is really just posting some notices, letting people know, you know, sending an email. I was going to ask you, Jody, this is something you might be interested in sort of helping us to coordinate, but maybe under these circumstances, not for. What is involved? I can email you what's involved, and then you can.
You mean the conflict of interest?
No, not the conflict, just, no, I'm happy to deal with the conflict of interest, the drug-free workplace.
Oh, probably have something to work.
Yeah, exactly. All we need to do is sort of.
Yeah, you need to post it.
Yes, if you could find out the process that they use, yeah, just copy it.
Yeah.
So that would be helpful.
And you, this is for the.
It's for the USDA. We have to.
For our staff.
Yes, for our staff.
So not to the school, not to the.
Just town staff.
Is that part of our personnel policy now?
No, we don't have anything in personnel policy. All right, so if you could do some research on that, that would be helpful. So that's the culvert. Even though it's not in the agenda as such, the fire engine, we've actually done the purchase order, signed the contract. USDA is not going to be able to review our loan request until early May. They're still working on the stormwater and wastewater stuff, of which our two requests were part of. So in early May, she said she'd be able to get on to that. And I thought maybe we had disqualified ourselves but already signed in the contract. She said no. So we're still in the running. If we get it, it's 2.75. So that would be nice, and we'll find out in May. Otherwise, the bond bank is.
Yeah, June, huh?
We'll know before then. But we get the month, yeah. Yeah, June or July, something like that, yeah. So that's the fire engine. The transfer station, that's the $190,000. The board felt that we could not, and this is one of the things we did in non-private a couple of weeks ago. Non-public, sorry. Because the USDA, you know, was talking about these at the time. So we decided to withdraw our application for the transfer station loan from the USDA because it would require more engineering oversight, and we feel that today we can bring this project in under budget. If we follow USDA, we feel strongly that we would not be able to. So we thank them very much, and we will likely now use the bond bank for that one. I guess that's it for that. As far as town hall drainage, we have not heard back from Mr. Gagnon. We sent in a notice of award. He had 15 days. So Caroline said she would follow up with him. That's kind of where the projects are right now. Are there any questions on that? On any of the? I will be talking to bond counsel tomorrow about our tax status. I don't know exactly what that means. She sent me some sheets, but she needs to be able to tell respective loan folks that yes, we are, our bonds are tax free, right? Municipal bonds are not subject to taxation. So they, the potential loaners, need that certification. So that's what this conversation will be tomorrow with bond counsel. She also told me, she called me today, she said that her engagement letter, which was for about $7,500 for fees, were geared towards one process, in other words, the bond bank. To the extent that we have the bond bank, one USDA loan for the culvert, possibly another USDA loan, that fee would increase. She is going to let me know. I'm not terribly concerned, because we've got, you know, $5,000 built in for her in the culvert, so, you know, so it's both in our operating budget and in some of these warrants, so we won't, I think we're not going to run into a financial trouble. She's going to ballpark it, the initial fee for us.
Well, thank you for managing it.
You're welcome. I'm hoping that we can get, we've got a couple of balls, we're not juggling anymore, but I'm hoping that I'm hoping we're not juggling any of them by the time I have to leave for 3 weeks. Yeah, exactly. Because, you know, as it is now, we have to make sure that there are these two of us, at least, who are signing these things, so. Okay, so I'm not gonna hyperventilate about it just yet. So, with regard to our transfer station project, one of the reasons that I think we can bring us in under budget is because, as with the road contract we had with Putty, for the reason that we did it, we also have a proposal from him for the transfer station for the repaving and the retaining wall. And it is just under $140,000. We have a quote from Atlantic Recycling. Could you,
yep.
I think, do you have both of those?
Do.
So let's talk about them and see if we want to act on them tonight. So we have what had been a proprietary proposal from Pike Industries to cover the paving and the regrading and the retaining wall for $139,685. So I'm going to put that aside for a minute. From Atlantic Recycling, we have a quote for them for the equipment, and we're going to change this because it is has two compactors and we only need one. So we'll change this to $7,200 for one compactor. And can you, does somebody have a calculator? If we take $37,395 and subtract $37,395.
So it's $3,195.
And we subtract $7,200, we get
$3,195.
That doesn't make sense. Because it's $37,000. $30,000. Makes sense. $195. Were you doing it? Do you have the same number?
I will do it again.
Is that $30,195? Okay, perfect.
Let me just do it again. So we're all okay. Read the numbers to me again.
$37,395. Minus
$7,200.
All right, so that takes care of the, so with the equipment and the Pike proposal, we have about $20,000 left for the concrete pads. We're in the process of getting quotes for the pads. And to the extent that it's over $20,000, I don't know that it will be. Jeff seems to think that we can get them in. But if it's over, we can always reduce the three pads to two pads and put the third one back on the CIP.
Okay.
So, Board, if you're willing to either talk about these things some more or actually vote to authorize these contracts?
One of the things on the Pike
yes.
is that they're going to be doing a 3-inch layer
okay.
of asphalt.
Yes.
So, just because of the heavy equipment that is going to be coming in and out constantly, because
yeah.
it has to carry that. I just think that's a good idea. Where on Bear Road we talked about an inch and a half to 2 inches, and you know, we went round and round
yes.
20 minutes on that.
I don't question a three-inch when you're dealing with...
Thank you for pointing that out.
When you're dealing with such heavy equipment, because they're going to be hauling out 12-ton loads every week.
So because of all the heavy equipment, the three-inch that we're putting there is a really good thing, and that's the justification for...
So when someone...
So when someone asks why that number is so high. Thank you. It's good to have you. Thank you for that.
You're welcome.
All right, anything else that we might notice? Okay, then if you're...
Move to accept the first one.
No, we'll sign the quote, and then we'll make it into a contract, just like we did the road, but we need to have a start.
Do we need a board number?
Yes.
I did pull out my book.
That's good. Let's do it.
Which one, the transfer station improvements, is warrant article number seven?
Is it seven?
Seven, okay. Move to accept proposal from Pike Industries for warrant article number seven for transfer station improvements for a total of $139,685.
I do it, you, because you're going to be bonding.
Oh, I'm sorry. I second. Thank you, Mike. I'll second that.
I'll support it, but just...
I understand. No, I understand. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye?
Aye.
All right. Thank you for being vigilant. I really appreciate it. Bonner is the town of Rollinsford. Okay.
Move to accept estimate from Atlantic Recycling Equipment for warrant article number seven, transfer station improvements, for a total of $30,195.
My second. I won't discuss, but let's initial this change here, both of us. That one in the total.
So...
Any discussion on this?
So we're confident that the cost of the compactors is as simple as just divided by two. There isn't a multiple purchase discount or anything? Could it buy more than one?
Yeah, I don't think so. I mean, I don't think so. I think if there is, we'll just absorb, yeah. And the other thing to point out is that, in case we don't, you know, some of us have forgotten, or the public would like to be reminded, the compactor is larger than the current one.
Correct.
So what we expect to do is reduce our operating costs by this compactor, both because we have two, and we will be doing full loads, which we've not been doing ever. And one of these loads will be bigger than the other one. So we're anticipating a reduction in operating costs. When we get these in motion and replaced, then we'll be able to, in next year's budget, I think we'll have enough experience to know what we've managed to save with that. Any other questions or comments on this? All right, I will call the question. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Sign it. This is just in two pages. Page two, okay. Yes. We've also been told, just FYI, that prices of asphalt are starting to creep up.
Yes.
So we're happy to have these things settled.
They're locked up.
Oh, yeah.
just for everything. Okay, copying scanning, so this is just, we don't have to address this tonight, but at some point I would really like us to look for alternatives to the RICO, yeah, so that we can upgrade and provide more reliable scanning.
It doesn't work, I think we have RICO, it works, yeah.
Which is probably fine, it's not the RICO, it's the age of this particular RICO.
Oh, it's the machine, no, I understand that.
Yeah, not a...
I think we found they were the best service for us, the most cost-effective and the best...
And that could, well, that could still be the case, so what we need to talk to them about is how can we upgrade this equipment and what would it cost us and blah, blah, blah.
Well, what line do you want to take that out of? They're ready to go when we're ready to go, but we didn't put it into the budget this year.
Do you know what it cost?
So they, well, no, that's just what I'm saying, is that they're ready to give us quotes.
Like, at least give us a quote, if we can't execute now, we can put it in the budget for next year.
Because she wants printing capability to that wirelessly, and, well, they all do, they all do that.
Yeah, absolutely, I would like, yeah, I mean, that's...
And it'll be a rental rather than an ownership.
Yeah.
So, does it come out of the supply line?
It would come out, so here's what we have available, it's a good question, so we have office equipment.
Yep.
Which has like 500, office equipment repairs, which has 1,000.
We have 400 left in office equipment.
And then, the, you know, we can look to the IT line.
Okay.
Now, there may not be enough there, I don't know how this is going to come back, right, there may not be enough.
Okay.
But it gives us the, then, what to think about for the following year.
Okay.
Super, so you'll follow up on that and get us some figures, I don't think there's any particular rush, but...
Yeah, I had done it at the beginning, and so I still have...
Okay, perfect. Yeah, just get us current.
Because they were like, oh, can we deliver it next week? Last time we talked to them, so I don't want to talk.
Oh, okay, good.
I don't want to talk to them again until we're ready to like...
Well, we're ready to consider it. How's that, we're ready to consider it, but we need to know what we're considering. I know when Bob did downstairs, he had some kind of deal where his daily, his regular operating expenses were going to go down, and it made up for his lease thing, so...
Right.
So who knows? You know, maybe...
It's pretty much unheard of to buy a machine these days.
Yeah, it is, exactly. Okay, let me find my agenda again here.
The technology changes that go down all the time. And ink is usually included in a lot of these rental agreements.
Or the, not the ink, but the...
Toner.
Toner.
Toner, that's right.
Yeah. It is, it's what provides the...
That's what we do, yeah.
All right, letter regarding the trees at Chinburg, I think that Caroline is trying to find the plans. Tom, you know, he's taking care of it, but Caroline needs to find the plan so that he can address it. So that's the hunt that's currently underway. New Hope housing tax exemption, we'll table it again, we haven't heard a final comment from our assessor. A water ban, so Caroline sent the board an email saying that a couple of residents have called in wondering if our water ban is still in existence, and it is, because we put it in place until rescinded. But it prompted Caroline to check in with DES to see what the drought situation was like, and I will read the response from DES. Unless somebody has it in front of them and gets it sooner.
We are still in a low category, but they show.
We're in moderate. I think we're in moderate, but...
We're not there yet.
We're not completely there.
Oh, water ban.
Water ban current...
We are currently in a moderate drought, still as below, this is on the agenda for tonight.
So here's what DES said. The New Hampshire Drought Management Team just issued this press release yesterday. So that would have been the 13th. And there's a link. And it's according to the U.S. Drought Monitor map, Rollinsford remains in the moderate drought area. The New Hampshire Drought Management Team is concerned that much of New Hampshire remains in drought status as we head into peak water usage time. Groundwater resources have not returned to normal as they lag behind surface water. At a minimum, voluntary restrictions are recommended. If we see below normal precipitation and above normal temperatures, New Hampshire could easily be in severe drought once again. So James Martin, Public Information Officer at DES.
Please maybe send that a reminder to folks. Tell something dramatic changes.
Well, okay, I mean, well, let's talk about it. So let's talk about what it means to people. It means that they can't put in new lawns, right? I mean, I believe what it said is no outdoor water usage. Is that correct? Can't wash cars.
Well, follow the right.
It's only wells.
I'm pretty sure it's only lawns. Okay, we all said, well, what about washing cars and all that? Filling pools. A whole host of things.
We should probably know what it is then, so let's...
We don't have our own ordinance. We had to follow whatever.
We had to follow the states. Yeah, I agree.
The emergency, the RSA.
Yes, and it was limited.
Very limited.
It was limited.
And I believe it was only to the lawns.
We need to know. I think we probably need to find it. So.
Check from the public health and safety restricting the use of water from private wells or public systems.
Oh, here it is. But we didn't. This isn't what we. We didn't vote on this because this was more than what we could. We didn't have a public vote.
Right.
This was just somebody's. So that's not what we voted on.
Correct.
Yeah. So we'll have to look it up.
What you asked me to do was take the text of the public
yes.
And incorporate it for Rollins. Right? Like basically just change Rollins, exit Rollins, with
yes.
A few minor tweaks. But then we found out we couldn't do it.
Exactly. So this is, you know, it's good for us to consider a larger ordinance. But in the meantime, we should at least know what we have put out. So let me get some information. I'll find it.
2016.
Say it again?
2016.
Yes, but we never voted on this. We didn't do this because we didn't have time. We had to act like right away.
Right.
And so all we could do as we read through some things was to implement the restricted water ban that the state said we could do without doing an ordinance. So it was just that I don't remember what that said, so we'll need to find it. Unless, you know, one of you can.
On the drive.
It should be somewhere. It should be on either the website or somewhere. So if you wanted to take a looky-see, I'll march down the. So rec committee, anything new and different with the rec committee?
We are meeting again next week. We have a signature to sign, a new hire. Yes, your water ban, due to ongoing extreme drought conditions, Rollins Borough issued a water ban banning watering of residential lawns. While the ban does not officially go into effect until September 27th, please consider the water uses carefully during this interim.
All it bans is the watering of lawns?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. All right, so shall we keep that in effect?
Mm-hmm. I would think.
All right, so we can just put out a little PR that says it's still in effect. And people can come talk to us if they... people are stressed. All right. Lost my agenda again. Historical committee, non-lapsing account. I put this back on because there was some movement to.
We haven't met since.
Is there anything to report, Mike? Or should we just.
I haven't met since
okay.
Last week. So.
All right.
So I have nothing to report.
Okay. Policies and procedures, welfare, Jody has agreed to work with Caroline in sort of finalizing that. Conflict of interest, so we need a conflict of interest policy for the USDA, so I cribbed something that online and sent you the link, and I thought we'd at least have a starting conversation about that and see if you had any questions or...
When did you send it?
When did I send it? No, last week.
Last week.
So, what I thought, so one of the things that it does is it says that we're going to ask some of the principal you know, the town officials and principals of the town to annually file a conflict of interest paper. My concern, I just, like, off the top of my head, just put the board, elected officials, so town clerk, town treasurer, the department heads, so I could actually, Chief Rutherford would be elected official, but, you know, Ducharme, Chief Ducharme, Jeff, and Carolyn. And what I thought it meant, maybe what we should do is ask Caroline to check with her listserv to see who it should, what do the other towns do, what do they cover? Does that make sense to you? You know, rather than just...
Why don't building has to sign it?
Every employee.
Every employee. Like, I'm on the Board of Dental Examiners, so I have to write that as a conflict of interest, in case anything ever came up. So, doesn't stop me from doing the job, it's just if anything ever came up.
Well, take, you know, so what if we do this? I'll ask Caroline to just check in, and then take a look at what I put for who needs to do it, and see if you want to enlarge that. And then next week, what I'm hoping to do is we can come and we can, you know, and see if we want to accept the policy or authorize the policy or adopt the policy. Does that seem okay? That way it gives us another week to think about it, and we'll get some information from Caroline. And drug-free workplace, Jody's already agreed to find us someplace that we can just emulate. All right, I'm at the end of our agenda. And town administration, standing items. One of them is board members' activities and updates. Michael?
I'm going to be with you all tomorrow evening, sitting in the same position, probably. Assuming we'll be at the same point.
Yes, we will be meeting at 6 o'clock with legal first. So, we'll be meeting with legal at 6, and at 6:30, the public grievance hearing will be here.
And do you have to figure out the taping or anything?
Yeah, I think, yeah, there are two people taping, so I think we're good.
Thank you.
So, it's not here, it's off my calendar.
6 o'clock, and then 6:30 here. And legal counsel will be Larry Gorman.
Oh, yeah.
Steve Roberts' office.
The Gorman and...
In Hopeful, Phoenix, yes, whatever. So, Jody, anything?
Yes, joint loss, the other day, rec committee meets again on Sunday, and she has to sign a, employee who are hiring, George Wall. So, also we heard back, she was there last year.
Excellent, so, did you see this, Michael?
No, she's attended all the meetings as well.
Actually, I have.
She's a deputy, that was...
She's a counselor.
Counselor.
Yes, counselor, so so what is the minimum wage, by the way, these days, in the industry?
$7.
Okay, so this is...
No, what's the federal minimum wage? It's not up to $7, no, it, New Hampshire doesn't have its own minimum wage.
Oh, okay, so, well, we're offering her $8.50, so that seems good. She's experienced in this, and she's in an early childhood program. So I thought she was very well qualified to do this. So are there any objections, or can I have a motion to offer Jordan Wall the position of camp counselor?
So moved.
$8.50, a second. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any movement on the director position, Jody?
Not that I've seen.
Okay. So, I will be at the meetings tomorrow. I have a stormwater, Seco Stormwater Coalition, this meeting. Wednesday, it's kind of a shirt sleeve session to work on the MS4 permit. Paul Casalt has agreed to go as well. He's on our stormwater committee, so that's a good thing to have. And I'm also meeting, I think, with one of the Eastman folks late tomorrow afternoon. One of the remaining Eastman folks. And I see there's an SRPC Friday meeting. So, busy week. building permits.
First one is 2017-029, 419 Boundary Street. They're putting on a new roof. Park has reviewed it. Fee is $145. They're doing the work themselves. There's two checks, but they miscalculated the fee. Next one is, permit number 2017-030, 484 Portland Avenue, it's new construction. Mr. Clark has reviewed it, and let them know about coordinating applicable inspections only. It is, fee is $2,055.
Oh yeah, that's the one that's been empty for a while now.
Just dropped off last week. Next
one
is,
that's right.
Next one is 2017-032. 426 Washington Street, denied. The applicant, so. They're replacing their
every once in a while, a board feels the need to be a little flipped, which is how it confuses.
Mr. Clark has reviewed it. It's going to be $65. Next is 2017-034, 487 Locust Street. Mr. Clark has reviewed. There is no fee. It's the Rollinsford School District. They are.
It's not a fence, is it?
Not a fence. We know that much.
Okay.
Windows.
Shed
and windows.
$5,500 at the heck of a shed. The concrete building, that's all I know. It's got rebar. That's the footing, so that's the foundation, I guess.
So they're gonna be building while summer camp's going on.
I guess.
Yep.
No, he wants to do it this week.
I guess I haven't gotten that far. It is indeed a shed. Sorry, I hadn't gotten that far yet. So that's what it looks like.
Oh, because the kids are on vacation.
Looks like a giant carport.
Okay.
Whatever. It doesn't matter. It's been reviewed by Mr. Clark. There's no fee, so we'll sign off on them.
So the culvert work is on Willie Street is likely going on in the summer.
Yes.
And
we're going to have to talk to them about how far the children are going to be able to go out that way and put up a red.
So there will be a pre-construction conference. So who would you like to attend on behalf of the rec committee? Okay. So when we come to that, that would be good. That would work out well. Just pay attention. Sure.
I actually have Jordan's around. I'll probably have Jordan come up too, so she's not with me. And
when we talked to the superintendent on Friday, with the
assistant isn't back in town for that.
Pardon?
The assistant back isn't back in town
okay.
for that. Sorry.
Well, so Tanner was here to say that the easement work itself is really pretty far removed from the school.
Yeah.
There was fencing, and that. The exit there would be kept open the whole time. Now, you won't be able to exit to the right. You have to exit to the left. But the exit would be open the whole time.
Right.
But it would still be helpful, I think, to have a rec committee member there.
Yeah.
And, you know, we'll know at that point, or they'll know, they'll be able to tell us what the schedule is.
So what is the rec committee meeting, Jim?
Next Sunday.
Sunday, so.
And then, sorry.
I don't know, the, ice game, right? Oh, no. The, is that under the rec department now? I don't remember.
We had placed it under the rec department.
Okay.
And we put in a bid, at the time, Tia had asked for $1,200 for this year's budget.
Yeah.
With the ice rink.
I was wondering, the liner's still there, they drove by, I saw it tonight.
Right, I guess there was communication between Kathy and Tia, but she hadn't responded yet.
Okay, so it's, we worked on, so.
It's her liner, so.
Oh, I got you.
She bought it.
But there's communication back and forth, so.
Paid for it, and, so.
Hate to say you got ruined, that's all.
Right.
We'll get them.
So.
You obviously got them controlled, so.
Are you?
I'm done, yeah, as soon as they come back, I'll put them back.
Okay.
Sorry, I was just curious.
No, thank you, Tom.
And then where they place this, this will add nice shade.
That's good, and ask them, or I guess we'll know sooner.
Yeah, right. We'll go next week.
That's for the ride, and not the one we want.
All right, so I guess we're ready for our folder.
All right, this file we've already gone through as the night has gone on.
Yeah.
And Avatar abatement.
Oh, yeah, all right, so this was an abatement that the board reviewed a while back, and we agreed with Avatar's recommendation, but they didn't have the form for us to sign. So this is, has the form for us to sign. And I can't remember, is it, if it's just one signature or all of us sign? What do you see there?
This one.
Or signature.
My signature, okay.
Oh, wait.
Oh. Okay, this is all of us, our signature, so.
This is the one on how?
This is.
Yes.
The minimal one.
Yes.
Reduces, yeah, from 209,000 to 207,000. So yes, it's very small. Revised assessment is here. Okay, date is the 17th.
Purchase order 1173 to B&B Printing, coming out of printing and copying line for 250 town report printing for a total of $2,482.50.
Okay, any discussion? This is for the, our town, our annual town report, and I think the budget is $3,000 or something, so. I'll call the question. All those in favor say aye.
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 Okay, this is from State of Hampshire Office of Energy and Planning. It is a required under RSA 78 blah blah blah. To estimate the annual population of New Hampshire communities. These estimates are part of a formula that is used to allocate state funds to your community. It is re- return to their office no later than Wednesday, May 31st, 2017. Asking for new construction, residential demolition, one family, two family, three, four family, five plus conversions, manufactured homes, et cetera.
Should we ask Caroline to work with Tom?
This is what Caroline talked about before we started the original budget poll.
Should we ask Caroline to work with Tom or whoever?
Yeah, she said she'd take care of it.
Okay, all right, so.
Jody wasn't here with that conversation.
And I forgot.
Let her know.
And I forgot, so. Do you have any post-its?
I do.
No, just, yeah, just to put, to say to Caroline that she, you know, she can take care of this, that's all. Smaller one, this is more economical.
Maybe just shut up on my desk.
Oh, that's right, those are the first you get, yes. One rabbit, was it Easter?
I don't know, I hope not, they came like 3 weeks ago, so it's funny with it going.
This is a correspondence to the select board from a PO box, no name.
No, I would prefer not to read it if it's anonymous. We have no idea who this is from, and it doesn't even have to be from that PO number.
Okay, fair enough.
It was PO box 309, is that where it was from?
I have no idea.
Yes.
Yes, that's the town hall, or PO box 309.
Yes, it's from 309 to 309.
Yeah, that's.
So, okay. Reports of claim of shipyard economic impact, 2016. Gives the demographics of all the towns. Rollinsford has 64 employees for a annual payroll of 4.7 million.
Oh, okay, so we can file that with our, so, you know, annual.
And there's other purchases, yeah. But that was the highlight of that. Okay. These are invoices from legal.
Yep, so I think it's good for the board to.
I looked over them, did Michael go over them?
I don't know, you want to see?
Are they new this week?
They're new this week, yeah. So this is the bed bugs, the sale of Jesse Doe, which continues, the work that we've asked him to do in Comcast, and general representation, which includes some background work on new public housing partnership requests. So those were the.
That's it?
That's it?
Everything else we've already done.
Okay.
Goes in the done box side.
Okay. So, any, I'll open it up to the public. Is there any comments in business? Yes, Amy.
In regards to Jeff and your hiring new employees and so forth, do you know if you have any paperwork completed with Department of Employment Services in New Hampshire, like Somersworth and Portsmouth? I was there today to drop something off for Rick.
Caroline has done something with them when we hire.
Okay, so we should already be in their database.
Yes.
Sure.
Yeah.
So,
and also, and he was talking about some service called Indeed. I think I'm not familiar with that. It's an online service, and there's our website, of course.
Because
and the Municipal Association.
The Rec Committee has actually updated their flyers because the deadline passed. It was Saturday to get applications in, and after talking to our person who's doing the hiring, realized that we didn't have a director in place yet, nor did we have sufficient counselors. So the new flyers will be going up, and it says apply as soon as possible, and it just says we're hiring director and counselor, no assistant director listed anymore.
Still don't have a lot of kids either. Not 20 kids.
Yeah.
What is the hope for number?
80.
Well, that was last year's. We didn't expect that many.
Last year, 100. Were registered, but not many, not
right.
All of them showed up.
They said an average of 30 kids showed up on a daily basis. It was the field trips that were bringing them. They didn't do a lot of field trips last year.
Okay.
So, yeah, we're looking, and I know Friday a couple more came in because I stopped by the office. Transfer station, we're moving forward with the contracts to revitalize it. At some point, some weeks ago, there was discussion that used to be the landfill, and we were supposed to be completing paperwork about that. Did all of that get resolved and the paperwork get completed? Or do we need to think about that before we do the work, or do we need to think about that while we're doing the work?
Okay.
he said that, right? He said.
I don't know what happened to that.
It's no longer in our thing. Maybe Caroline filled it out. Yeah, I thought we did actually. But let me check in with her. Good question. I don't know the.
Because if we're tearing things up, then we're going to be working
that in. We're not doing much in the way of disturbance.
Okay.
So. And we did have the environmental, DES is already kind of, because we filed a preliminary engineering report with all of that. And so we're okay with DES and with. It doesn't require any permitting because there's so little perturbation that's going to happen.
We're okay with one part of DES.
Okay.
But this other letter came from another part of the department, so.
Yeah.
And you're assuming that both, all pieces are talking to one another. That doesn't, that may happen, DES, I don't know.
Okay.
But I think it's a good point.
Yep, thank you. Anything else? Yes, thank you.
I know I'm not part of the water district, but does the water district actually have the say on water bans?
Well, the town does. The town does. Now, when we made that decision, we did invite the water district because clearly they are an important player, and it was good to have their support. We did have their full support for the water ban. So, but that's a good point. I'll keep them. We'll send them a notice that we're not ready to lift it.
Thank you.
Yeah,
Michael
was here that night, right?
Michael LaPointe. I think they were all here. I think Dennis was here.
Oh, that's right.
Dennis and Mike.
They were all here. And what they did say too was that their water supply was in good shape, but
correct.
But nonetheless, I mean, they pulled from the general water table,
right.
So,
right.
So, you know, we were all in agreement to do this. Yes, my note says to check in with the water district, let them know that we're doing it, and then, yes, we'll put it on the website when we will put it in the letter. That's good, thank you for reminding me. So not just the website, but also newsletter. When do you need that stuff again, Sally? End of this month?
End of this week.
End of this week? Okay.
Can we put more of what is actually going on, like, warrant-wise this time?
We're going to see if it's still right.
Oh, I just figured you'd pull from the anyway.
What?
I thought you'd just pull it from her notes. But yeah, I just wanted the newsletter to be more, there's a lot going on in town for us.
Yes.
Yes.
So
I can give an update on our projects.
So yeah.
Right.
So
is that, and I'll
I
send out a draft.
That's going to be the bulk of the newsletter.
Yes. I'll send out a draft for the board to look at.
Yeah.
You know, they're in various stages, but you know, we'll just say where they are. I should write that down so I don't forget it. Should not. Yes, I should. That's okay. Thank you. All right.
Are we going to contract?
No, we don't have that. Sorry, that never
cross
got,
it off.
Cross it off. That was a mistake. That was a leftover.
Perfect.
We don't have anything here. We are done.